Humphrey stumbled forward. It took everything he had to put one foot in front of the other, but he persisted despite the immense effort it required. The knife wound in his shoulder had become infected 2 days ago. Or was it three? He was no longer certain. The days began to blur together as the pain spread and his fever grew. To make matters worse, he couldn't trust his ability to recognize the passage of time. Twice now, he'd come to his senses to find himself stumbling through unfamiliar territory, his body powering him onward, while his brain had been on hiatus. His vision was growing progressively more blurry as the afternoon wore on. Possibly the glancing blow he'd taken to the side of the head during his escape hadn't been that glancing after all. The expedition had started out well enough. The map had been a godsend. Farini had laid out the steps they were to follow with a surveyor's precision, and Humphrey had taken his team from one waypoint to the next with minimal difficulty. Each time they'd located another of Farini's landmarks, Humphrey had grown more convinced they would find the lost city of the Kalahari, just as Farini and his son had done nearly a century earlier. Everything had been progressing just as planned. That was, until Barnes shot the San tribesman. The mean-hearted bastard claimed it was an accident, but Humphrey had overheard talk of bagging a trophy, as if the natives of the Kalahari were no better than the wildlife around them. They had awoken the morning after the San's death to find the tires on all their vehicles slashed and all their gas tanks punctured and empty. A look under the vehicle's hoods had revealed even more damage. More than the destruction, what frightened Humphrey was the fact that all this had been done while the men slept only a few feet away. Not one of them had heard the San. Humphrey knew he had entirely lost control of the expedition at that point. His pleas to try to communicate with the tribesmen had been shouted down by the more militant members of his entourage, and soon there had been a mini coup, as he was supplanted in his role of expedition leader by none other than that idiot, Barnes. Fool. He deserved everything he'd gotten as a result. They'd tied Humphrey's hands and lashed him to a nearby baobab tree to keep him from interfering as they'd settled into defensive positions around the camp, ready for the tribesmen should they return. Stumbling along, Humphrey shook his head at the memory. The San had come with a vengeance, and within moments of their arrival, the entire camp had been engulfed in chaos. He knew he would never forget the sight of the San leader on a massive bull elephant as it reared over Barnes, ready to crush him with its forelegs. The knife wound had come from one of his own men. Possible concussion was a gift from a San tribesman with a club made of elephant bone. Humphrey had been on the run since. The Kalahari Desert was not a forgiving place, and even in his fevered state, he knew that if he didn't find help and shelter soon, he wouldn't live to see next week. It took everything he had just to keep moving forward. A full moon, when had it become night, gave him just enough light to avoid the major obstacles in his path. Not that there were all that many. Aside from the occasional baobab tree, the Kalahari was pretty much flat pans and scrubland. He used the moon as a guide, stumbling toward it to prevent himself from traveling in circles. Humphrey spun, nearly toppling to the ground. All he saw was the mottled brown back of an animal keeping pace with him. Fear pooled in his belly. Hyenas. Humphrey had been in Africa long enough to recognize the hyena call to alert the rest of the pack of a food source. In minutes, he would be surrounded. He couldn't outrun them. His only hope was to find a place where he could hole up away from them and wait for the pack to grow discouraged and wander away. Humphrey staggered on, lost in delirium. And when he came to his senses next, his two hyena companions had grown to a pack of six or more. They moved through the scrub on all sides of him. Tears began to course down his cheeks, matching the blood now running down his arm as his exertion reopened his shoulder wound. One foot in front of the other. One foot in front of the other. The lead hyena dashed toward him from the side. He turned to face it, waving his arms, and it broke off the charge, disappearing into the darkness. Humphrey glanced around, searching desperately for something, anything that could help him, when his gaze fell upon a large baobab tree about 100 yards off to his left. He angled his path in that direction and wanted to shout for joy when he reached the massive trunk of the baobab tree. He couldn't climb it. The nearest branches were 30 feet above his head. But with his back against it, he would at least be safe from an attack from behind. Humphrey had reached the end of his endurance. His legs wouldn't even hold him upright anymore. He slid to the ground, his feet splayed out before him. His hands fell on some of the hard, baseball-sized fruit scattered at the base of the tree, and he snatched them up. They were a poor excuse for a weapon, but they would have to do. He got to test them out a few seconds later. He struck the hyena's nose, startling it enough that it retreated into the scrub. 3 more of the hyenas advanced out of the brush and cautiously made their way forward.
Go away! Beat it, go on!
Humphrey felt around on the ground beside him until he found a good-sized rock. He clutched it, determined to defend himself to the last. The hyenas crept forward, their muzzles low to the ground, their lips pulled back. Suddenly, the lead hyena's ears pointed forward. A moment passed, and then the trio turned as one, dashing into the darkness. Even in the depths of his fever, Humphrey knew their sudden departure wasn't a good sign. Only a lion or some other large predator could make a pack of hyenas abandon an all but certain kill. He gripped his makeshift weapon tighter and prepared for the worst. A minute passed. 2. Humphrey's vision swam, and his head began to sag toward his chest as darkness sought to drag him down. A San tribesman was squatting a few feet in front of him, watching him with eyes as emotionless as slate. He wore nothing but a loincloth, the rest of his skin covered with some kind of muddy paste that would make it easy for him to blend into the background. In his left hand, he held a spear, the butt of which rested on the ground, the tip pointing skyward. Without a change of expression, the San warrior raised his other hand to his mouth. Humphrey watched a cloud of dust burst from the man's closed fist. His throat closed up immediately. He fought to take in another breath, but it was no use. The darkness closed in quickly, his view of the San warrior in front of him swiftly dwindling, until all he could see was the man's dark eyes. Then the darkness claimed him entirely.
Graphic Audio presents Rogue Angel by Alex Archer. Rogue Angel number 42, The Vanishing Tribe. Narrated by Nanette Savard. With performances by Colleen Delany, Bradley Smith, James Lewis, Thomas Keegan, Patrick Bussink, Danny Gavigan, Kenyatta Rogers, Ken Jackson, Yasmin Tuazon, Joe Brack, Michael Glenn, Terence Aselford, and Dylan Lynch.
Annja Creed glanced across the platform to where her cameraman, Lenny Davis, was seated. In the dim light, he was hard to see, but she knew where he was because they'd both been sitting in the same place for 2 weeks. The two were deep in the Jiundu swamp in northwestern Botswana, following up on a recent rash of Batman sightings and trying to catch some footage of the alleged creature. It was their latest assignment for Chasing History's Monsters, the cable television show Annja co-hosted. The show focused on exactly what its name indicated: historical madmen, psychopaths, serial killers, and even legendary monsters. Hence the reason they were on a platform 10 feet off the ground, using low-light cameras to try to catch a glimpse of what their producer, Doug Morrell, was calling the scoop of the century. Of course, he'd said the same thing about the past 3 assignments he'd sent them on, including one where he'd had them trying to film the ghost of a man-eating great white shark off the coast of Indonesia, which was why Annja didn't place much stock in his assessment. She stretched her legs out in front of her, trying to keep from cramping.
Did you hear that?
I didn't hear anything.
There it is again! Listen!
Lenny climbed to his feet, silhouetted in the dim moonlight. This time, Annja did hear something. It was faint, hard to identify over the typical night noises coming out of the swamp.
I hear it. But what the heck is it?
Annja didn't think for a moment that it was an actual Batman. She was expecting to find a perfectly natural explanation for the so-called sightings that had occurred over the past several months. An unusually large vulture, perhaps. Or maybe some unknown species of bird, driven out of the deeper swamps by the recent rainy season. Either would make far more sense than the mysterious bat people Doug was convinced were hiding here. Annja rose to her feet and tried to get a fix on the sound. It was getting closer, but she couldn't pin down which direction it was coming from. The quarter moon wasn't much help. What little light it cast added more shadows than it illuminated.
Behind you!
Annja turned just in time to see a dark winged shape swoop down at her from the nearby tree with stunning speed. She dropped into a crouch, bringing her arms up over her head to protect herself as the thing flew past. She quickly got back to her feet, but it had already disappeared into the darkness.
What the hell was that?
Annja didn't have any answers. She'd barely gotten a glance at it. But it could also be the very thing that they'd come to find. The Batmen of Botswana.
Get those cameras rolling, Lenny.
Cameras 1, 2, and 3 are live. 4 is giving me some trouble, but I should have it online in another moment or two.
Good, we don't want to miss this thing a second.
Look out!
Annja was turning when she felt claws rake her left shoulder. Pain flared down her arm, and then the thing was gone again. If it came back, which it most likely would, this time she would be prepared to meet it on its own terms. She'd been using a walking stick to help her navigate the uncertain terrain of the swamp for the past few days, and she snatched it up now, holding it before her in two hands like a baseball bat.
Do you see it?
Lenny didn't respond. He was standing with his back to her, fumbling with something in front of him that she couldn't see.
Something isn't right. That strange buzzing sound the creature makes whenever it swipes at us, the lack of aerobatics from a creature supposedly born to fly, Lenny's current distraction. Oh, jeez, Louise, I can't believe it took me so long to figure it out!
It's coming back, I think!
This time, Annja was ready for it. She had some idea what was causing that sound now, and she intended to put her theory to the test.
Here it comes again!
Suddenly, the creature was diving at them for the third time that night. Annja brought her staff around in a vicious swing.
No, Annja!
Annja saw the creature go careening off in an uncontrolled spin. A moment later, it crashed 10 feet below them. Annja headed for the ladder.
What are you doing?
Putting an end to this right now.
Annja descended from the platform and then pulled her flashlight out of her pocket. Flipping it on, she cast about for a few minutes before locating the object she'd struck with her staff. She hurried over and shone her light on the wreckage. The so-called Batman was in reality nothing more than a medium-sized drone with a pair of motorized wings and some special effects added to give the suggestion of something more when glimpsed in the near dark. Annja looked up as Lenny finally joined her. Her expression must have reflected a fair bit of what she was feeling because he winced.
I think you have some explaining to do.
Would you believe this was all Doug's idea?
I would indeed.
After listening to Lenny's explanation about the drone, Annja decided she was done with the episode and stalked back to their rented Nissan SUV. Lenny followed sheepishly in her wake. The ride back to their hotel passed in silence, and Annja retired to her room as soon as they arrived. There, she finally got a chance to look at the shoulder wound. It turned out to be minor, a deep scrape most likely caused by the outer edge of the drone's wing as it swept past her. She cleaned it out, bandaged it, and fell into bed exhausted. The sun woke Annja just after 9 the next morning. She rose, dressed, and ran through her usual routine of morning stretches to awaken her body in preparation for the harder exercise to follow. This morning, her arm was a little stiff, but she quickly worked out the kinks as she ran through her warm-up exercises. When her muscles were good and limber, she reached into the otherwear. The gleaming medieval broadsword appeared in her hand. Her life hadn't been the same since that fateful day when she'd brought the broken, scattered pieces of the sword together for the first time since their original owner, Joan of Arc, had been burned at the stake 500 years earlier. The sword had miraculously reformed in a flash of power right before her very eyes, and in some strange way she still didn't understand, had chosen her to be its next bearer. The role came with its own unique set of responsibilities, protecting the innocent first and foremost among them. It wasn't a life she would have chosen for herself, but now that she was in it, she couldn't imagine doing anything else. Anja slipped into a series of movements designed to continue honing her already considerable skills with the weapon. Kata after kata flowed out of her as naturally as water from a spring, and Anja quickly found herself lost in the synergy of thought and motion, becoming one with the sword in such a way that it ceased being a separate object, but was instead an extension of body and mind. When she finally slowed to a stop over an hour later, she felt energized and ready to take on the day. She released the sword back into the otherwhere. Anja showered, changed, and left the hotel behind, looking for a place to eat. Upon arrival in Botswana, they had set up a base of operations in Maun, the district capital of northwestern Botswana, that served as the jumping-off point for exploration of the Okavango Delta to the north and the Makadikadi salt pans to the east. What had once been a small village along the wide banks of the Thalamakane River had grown over the past couple of decades into a town of some 40,000 people. It was an interesting mixture of the old and the new, where hotels, lodges, and even a rental car facility vied for room with square cinder block homes with tin roofs and small herds of donkeys and goats every morning when the local farmers brought their goods to market. Anja found a small cafe just down the street from the hotel and had a leisurely breakfast. When her breakfast was over, she snatched up her cell phone, dialed the familiar New York number, and waited.
Doug Morrell?
What do you think you're doing?
Right now, I'm drafting a memo to marketing about...
Don't give me that nonsense. You know exactly what I'm talking about.
Actually, I don't. I can hear that you're upset, Anja, but,
Of course I'm upset. Did you think I wouldn't find out?
Find out about what? I really don't understand.
You had the special effects department create a simulated Batman and coerced my cameraman into using it when it looked like we wouldn't get any real footage. Something I told you would happen before we even left the States.
I have no idea what you're talking about, Anja.
Good. Then you certainly won't mind that I practiced my Babe Ruth impression on it with my hiking staff and knocked it out of the sky in mid-flight.
What? Are you insane? Do you have any idea what that thing costs? Effects is going to kill me! Never mind what accounting is going to do with my budget!
I thought you had no idea what I was talking about.
You see, it was strictly a backup plan.
Anja let him babble for several minutes as she sipped her coffee. Doug had tried to enhance, his word, not hers, her shows with special effects in the past, and each time she'd soundly shot him down. This time he'd conspired to do it behind her back, with her cameraman, no less. A message needed to be sent.
And so I took it upon myself to support you.
Doug?
Yes, Anja?
I'm taking the day off, Doug. I'm going to do a little shopping, eat out at an expensive restaurant, and generally enjoy myself. Come tomorrow, when I'm in a better mood, we'll talk about what we're going to do next. Understood? Good.
Anja finished her coffee, paid the check, and then stepped out the door. There were several clothing stores around the cafe where she'd just had breakfast. If she didn't find anything there, she would wander back past the hotel to the large outdoor bazaar that filled the streets for several blocks in that direction. The first couple of stores didn't have anything that interested her, but the third one was full of fabrics dyed in brilliant hues, and she quickly fell in love with several items. The proprietor, a woman a few years younger than Anja, took particular pride in showing her around the shop. She quickly found her irritation at Doug and the events of the night before slipping away in the wake of the young woman's enthusiasm over helping her. In the end, Anja bought several brightly colored tops and even a beautifully cut sundress just to show her appreciation. Anja was headed out of the shop when a small white sign stuck in the corner of the window caught her eye. She leaned closer for a better look.
Public notice of auction. Personal effects of explorer and adventurer Robert C. Humphrey. Willoughby's Auction House, 10 a.m. today only.
Huh. Robert Humphrey. I know that name.
A glance at her watch told Annja it was a few minutes before 10. If she hurried, she might just make it. She stepped back inside the shop.
Forget something, miss?
Willoughby's auction house. Is it far?
No, miss. Not far at all. 4 blocks up on the right, above the post office.
Thanks.
Annja hurried up the street. The post office wasn't hard to find, and a quick question to one of the locals standing in line outside brought her around the side of the building where a staircase led up to the second floor. A door at the top opened up into a wide room that was clearly the site of the event, even if the large Willoughby's banner across the back of the room was any indication. The auction was already underway when Annja slipped inside and found a seat in the back. She was surprised by the turnout. About 2 dozen people, many of them clearly not locals, filled the rows of chairs in front of the auctioneer's podium. The sale moved along briskly, and Annja was amazed, not only by the scope and variety of the items up for bid, but also the amounts individual buyers were willing to pay for them. Humphrey, she remembered, had once been a highly respected adventurer. He'd been the height of celebrity back in the mid-80s, thanks to a series of well-publicized activities, such as climbing without oxygen, the highest mountain on each continent, dog sledding solo across the South Pole, and breaking the record for circumnavigating the Earth by hot air balloon. Then a tabloid paper had revealed that Humphrey had sunk several million dollars into an effort to prove the existence of the abominable snowman, or Yeti. The public had laughed it off. But then other reporters began digging deeper, and it quickly became apparent that Humphrey had more than just one pet project. UFOs, pyramid power, Bigfoot, Nessie, the Hollow Earth theory. Name just about any subject on the outer edge of science and myth, and Humphrey was involved in it somehow. When the information came to light, he went public with his enthusiasm for all things esoteric and paranormal. The reporters went on a feeding frenzy. Humphrey had withdrawn from the public eye for many years. From time to time, you would hear that he was involved in some crazy expedition or another, like the time he'd tried to retrace the route taken through the Amazon jungle by Colonel Percy Fawcett in his quest to find the ancient city known only as Z. Listening in on the conversations around her, Annja learned that Humphrey had been living here in Maun for at least the past 10 years, possibly longer. He'd disappear into the outback for weeks at a time, hunting for who knew what.
Maybe he was looking for the Batman of Jiundu as well. He certainly chased crazier ideas than that.
Humphrey and his entire expedition had disappeared 2 years ago while chasing down the legend of the lost city of the Kalahari, an ancient city of enormous proportions, supposedly built by the ancestors of the modern-day San tribesmen. Given that the San had been one of the most nomadic peoples on the planet, Annja found the idea that they'd built a massive city in the desert ludicrous. She was just about to get up and make her way out of the auction when a new item was introduced that caught her eye. It was a small drawing on what looked to be old parchment paper, mounted in a simple wooden frame.
Our next piece shows an artist's representation of Lake Makarikari in its heyday, somewhere around 20,000 years ago. Mr. Humphrey's records indicate that this drawing was done by a man named Gelarmi Farini in 1895, though we have not been able to substantiate his claim. Is it possible? Certainly. Is it likely? I am afraid we can't answer that. So, let's start the bidding on this fine piece at $50. Do I hear 50?
On impulse, Annja raised her hand.
$50 from the lady in the eighth row. Do I hear 75? $75!
A man a few rows in front of Annja raised his hand.
75 it is. Can I get 100? $100!
Anya's hand went up a second time.
$100! Do I hear 125?
For a moment, Annja thought the man a few rows ahead of her was going to bid again, but he must have thought better of it. He let the moment pass.
125! Do I hear 125? No? Then it's $100 going once, $100 going twice, and sold to the woman in the eighth row.
No sooner had the auctioneer finished than the doors in the back of the room were thrown open and a man rushed inside.
Stop! Stop right now!
He was a big man, both in height and weight. His blonde hair fell just over the collar of his white Panama suit, and his blue eyes were wide. He rushed down the center aisle toward the auctioneer, a mountain of a man moving with far more dexterity than Annja would have imagined possible.
That drawing belongs to me!
I am sorry, sir, but you are too late.
Too late? Do you have any idea who I am? That drawing belongs to me, I tell you!
And I'm telling you, sir, that the image belongs to the young lady in the eighth row who just legally purchased it.
Annja watched as the big man spun around, his gaze first seeking and then finding her in her seat. She watched as the big man stalked toward her. She could see he was younger than she'd first thought, definitely closer to 20 than 30. But that still didn't give her any clue as to who he was or why he thought the drawing belonged to him. He stopped and stood over her, glaring down.
That drawing belongs to me. I said that—
I know what you said, but I'm afraid I have to disagree. The art belongs to me. If you wanted it, you should have been here to bid on it.
Do you know who I am? Do you have any idea how difficult I can make things for you?
He leaned in close and shoved a finger in her face.
You have no idea what you've gotten yourself into.
Without a change of expression, Annja grabbed his finger and twisted it. Then she stood. Annja applied pressure to his finger in such a way that he was forced to let her lead him.
Didn't your mother teach you not to point?
She was about to lead him down the aisle and out of the doors. Instead, she glanced up as four men in blue shirts and black slacks crossed the room toward her.
Security, miss. We're here to escort Mr. Potter out.
Be my guest.
They grabbed his arms and pulled him away.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.